Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushti Vadanam Urvarakameva Bandhanan Mityor Mukshya Mamritat Om Sarvesham Svastir Bhavatu Sarvesham Shantir Bhavatu Sarvesham Purnam Bhavatu Sarvesham Mangalam Bhavatu Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina Sarve Santu Niramaya Sarve Badrani Pashyantu Makasche Dukabhag Bhavet Asato Ma Sat Gamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotir Gamaya Mrityor Ma Amritam Gamaya Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnam Adayam Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Om Peace 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 O Dob Lord of mercy and love, salutations and prostrations unto thee. Thou art omnipresent, omnipotent, and omniscient. Thou art Satchit Ananda. Thou art existence, knowledge, and bliss absolute. Thou art the indweller of all beings. Grant us an understanding heart, equal vision, balanced mind, faith, devotion, and wisdom. Grant us inner spiritual strength to resist temptation and to control the mind. Free us from egoism, lust, anger, greed, hatred, and jealousy. Fill our hearts with divine virtues. Let us behold in all these names and forms. Let us serve thee in all these names and forms. Let us ever remember thee. Let us ever sing thy glories. Let thy name be ever on our lips. Let us abide in thee forever and ever. Jai. Jai. Jai Jayarati Vigna Vinayaka Vigna Vinayaka Shri Ganesha Jai Jayarati Subramanya Subramanya Kartikeya Jai Jayarati Venugopala Venugopala Venu Lola Papa Vidura Navanita Chora Jai Jayarati Venkataramana Venkataramana Sankatarana Sitarama Radhe Shyama Jai Jayarati Gauri Manohara Gauri Manohara Bhavani Shankara Samba Sadashiva Uma Maheshwara Jai Jayarati Raja Rajeshwari Raja Rajeshwari Tripura Sundari Mahalakshmi Mahasaraswati Mahakali Mahashakti Jai Jayarati Anjaneya Anjaneya Hanumanta Jai Jayarati Dattatreya Dattatreya Trimurti Avatara Jai Jayarati Adityaya Adityaya Bahaskaraya Jai Jayarati Shanishwaraya Shanishwaraya Bhaskaraya Jai Jayarati Shankaracharya Shankaracharya Advaita Gurave Jai Jayarati Satguru Nata Satguru Nata Shiva Nanda Jai Jayarati Vishnu Devananda Vishnu Devananda Vishnu Devananda Jai Jayarati Agastya Munaye Agastya Munaye Shri Rama Priyaye Jai Jayarati Ayappa Swamiye Ayappa Swamiye Dharma Shastave Jai Jayarati Jesus Gurave Moses Gurave Buddha Gurave Jai Jayarati Muhammad Gurave Guru Nana Gurave Samasta Gurbhyo Namaha Jai Jayarati Venugopala Om Natatra Suryobhati Nachandra Tarakam Nama Vidyoto Bantikotoya Magnihi Tameva Bantamanubhati Sarvam Tasya Basa Savamidam Vibhati Om Gange Chayamune Chaiva Godavari Saraswati Narmade Sindukaveri Namastubhyam Namo Namaha Tvameva Mata Chapita Tvameva Bandhu Chasaka Tvameva Vidya Dravinam Tvameva Sarvam Mama Deva Deva Kayena Vacha Manasendriyarva Buddhiyatmanava Prakriter Swabhavad Karomi Adhyad Sakalam Parasmai Narayana Iti samar payami savadharman parityaja mamekam sharanam vraja aham tva sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami ma sucha.
Guru paramparam shruti smriti purananam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavat Pada Shankaram Loka Shankaram Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Kritau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 By Bhagavan's grace and Swamiji's blessings, and by the grace of Mahatmas, definitely, we're able to begin this next Upanishad, Aitareya Upanishad. Swamiji must have thought of selecting this Upanishad, because this is also one of the 10 major Upanishads. You all must have heard this one small, simple verse. A verse itself presents these 10 important Upanishads. Isha kena katha prashna munda manduki tittirihi aitareyam chandogyam aitareyam cha chandogyam brihadaranyakam tatha. This one verse. In Sanskritam, any definition, everything they want to present in the verse form. You can memorize the verse and you have all the contents. What are the 10 important Upanishads? Isha kena katha prashna munda mandukya tittirihi aitareyam cha chandogyam brihadaranyakam tatha. What does this verse say? Nothing. It will give us a list of 10 Upanishads. So here you can see the Aitareyam also is mentioned in this verse as one of the 10 major Upanishads. Which means these 10 are important. Others, that does not mean others are not important. All the Upanishads are equally great, equally important, equally convey the same message. But they are known as 10 major Upanishads because Shankara Bhagavatpada has written commentary on these Upanishads. He has not taken other Upanishads for writing commentary. Maybe if he lived longer, he might have written for all the Upanishads also. He died very young. These 10. But it is always said that the Upanishad, all the Upanishads present different topics, important topics. That is why Upanishads also come under the philosophical literature, the category of philosophical literature. What are the topics discussed? What are the topics that should be discussed in any philosophical literature? Even though Upanishad is not just a philosophy, it is a text revealing the fact as a pramana grantaha. Because philosophy means a view, a contention. A person's thinking is involved, whereas here Upanishads are revelations of rishis. But still, Upanishad also presents the 6 topics. That is, Jivaha, Ishvaraha, Jivaha, the individual being, Ishvaraha, the Lord, Jagat, the universe or the cosmos, Bandhaha, bondage, Mokshaha, freedom, and Moksha Sadhanam, the means of attainment of freedom. These are the important 6 factors discussed in the Upanishads. All other philosophies, all other systems of philosophy also discuss these factors. Even though they have different contentions and different views, including the atheists, including the Nastikas, whether a system of philosophy is a Nastika Darshanam or a Nastika Darshanam, whether believers or non-believers, whether they accept the Veda Shastram or do not accept the Veda Shastram, or whether they believe in God, they do not believe in God, still they all discuss these six topics. How even an atheist should say, even to say that God is not there, he must discuss God. So, these six topics are inevitably discussed in the systems of philosophy. Even though Upanishad is not just a philosophy, it's a Pramana Grantaha, Upanishad presents these six topics. But all these six topics are not systematically presented in the Upanishads. All over Upanishads, these facts are scattered in the most stray statements. Therefore, it is not easy to understand the Upanishads, the teaching directly when we enter into the textbook with limited knowledge of Sanskritam or even with a great scholarship on Sanskritam. If anybody enters into this Upanishad study by himself independently, one cannot understand the hidden tale of what is being said there. Because of course all these factors are discussed, but there are stray statements to scattered all over. That is why we are very, very grateful to Vyasa Bhagavan, Vyasa Acharya, who has compiled the mantras and who has presented these. Not only he has compiled all the four Vedas, specifically he has also given us the greatest blessing in the form of his textbook called Brahma Sutrani. Only in the Brahma Sutras, Upanishadic teaching is reproduced, presented by Vyasacharya. So Brahma Sutrani is a textbook. Brahma Sutrani is a textbook authored by Vyasacharya, which alone should be taken as the basic Vedantic philosophy, Vedantic teaching. Why? Because only in the Brahma Sutras, the Upanishadic teaching is made very clear. Brahma Sutras, even though they are authored by Vyasacharya, the content of the Brahma Sutras is nothing but Upanishadic teaching. Which means Vyasacharya is not the founder of the Vedanta Shastram, not the author of the Vedanta Shastram. He is author of the Brahma Sutrani, which presents the Upanishadic teaching, which is timeless wisdom. So there, in Brahma Sutrani, Vyasacharya has systematically presented these factors. Six factors. As he said, Jivaha, Ishwaraha, Jagat, Bandaha, Mokshaha, Moksha Sadhanam, the means of attainment of freedom. These six factors, he has presented it very clearly, he has discussed. And later on, Vyasacharya's work has been elucidated by Shankara Bhagavatpada by writing commentary on those Brahma Sutrani. So this itself makes it very clear. Vedantic vision, Advaita Darshanam, the vision of non-duality is not a new fact presented by Shankara. It is not a system of philosophy which has been established by Shankaracharya or Vyasacharya. It's a timeless wisdom revealed in the timeless scripture Upanishads, which the teaching of which has been later on systematically presented by Vyasacharya in his Brahma Sutrani. And much later, elucidated by Shankara Bhagavatpada. this must be very clear. And as Vyasacharya has written Nibbana Sutrani, in his Brahma Sutrani, which is known as analytical study of the Upanishad mantras, it's called Vedanta Mimamsa Shastram. Brahma Sutrani is a textbook known as Mimamsa Shastram, Vedanta Mimamsa Shastram, analytical study of the Upanishad mantras. And in his analysis, Vyasa Bhagavan has mostly used the mantras from these 10 Upanishads. These 10 Upanishads. As Vyasa Bhagavan has used, taken mantras from these 10 Upanishads for analysis, for analytical study, Shankar Bhagavatpada also decided to write commentary on these 10 Upanishads mainly, in order to make the Brahma Sutra study easy. With the thorough understanding of the teaching of these 10 Upanishads, if a person enters into the Brahma Sutra study, analytical study, then it will be much easier, clearer for him to and get the clear vision of the Upanishads. This is the reason why Shankara Bhagavatpada has written commentary on this Upanishad also. This is the one reason. Another reason is also given here. If we see these 10 Upanishads, they belong to 4 different Vedas. So we separate this, Yajurvedaha. Yajurvedaha, we have 2 parts as Krishna Yajurvedaha and Shukla Yajurvedaha. Kathopanishad and the Taittiriya Upanishad, which we studied before, these 2 Upanishads belong to Krishna Yajurvedaha. Kathopanishad and Taittiriya Upanishad belong to Krishna Yajurvedaha. And Ishavasyam and Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, 2 Upanishads belong to Shukla Yajurvedaha. Then Kena Upanishad and Chandogya Upanishad belong to Samavedaha. Chandogya, Kena and Chandogya. Kena Upanishad and Chandogya Upanishad belong to Samavedaha. Now, Prashna Upanishad, Mundaka Upanishad and Mandukya Upanishad. Prashna Upanishad, Mundaka Upanishad and Mandukya Upanishad. These 3 Upanishads belong to Atharvana Vedaha. Now you have seen all Upanishads belonging to 3 Vedas. Where is the Upanishad of Rig Vedaha? We only come across 9 now. Therefore, Aitareya Upanishad has been taken from Rigveda. So totally you got 10 Upanishads belonging to 4 different Vedas. Why I have to categorize and show you which Upanishad belongs to which Veda? Shankara Bhagavatpada is very conscious of selecting the Upanishads so that it is easy for him to point out the fact that all the Upanishads convey the same message. This presenting the fact of all the Upanishads conveying the same message is said to be Gati Samanya Nyaya. Gati Samanya Nyaya. Gatihi means end. Samanyam means the same. Okay, the Nyaya means the analogy of revealing all the Upanishads having the same subject matter and the same goal, same aim. There is no difference, which means all the Upanishads present all moksha being the ultimate goal. All the Upanishads reveal jnanam being the only means of attaining moksha. And knowledge is actually Jiva Ishvara Swarupa Aikyam, the one, knowledge of the oneness of the reality. To make it brief, we can say Jiva Jagad Ishvara Swarupa Aikya Jnanam. Jiva Ishvara Jagat, or you can say Jiva Jagat Ishvara Swarupa Aikya Jnanam. Knowledge of the oneness of the reality of the individual, the total, the macrocosmic being, and the Lord. This is the vision of all the Upanishads. So to also to show that all the Upanishads convey the same teaching, present the same teaching, convey the same message, Shankara Bhagavatpada has chosen this Upanishad from Rigveda. And we should also remember there's another Kaushitaki Upanishad which also belongs to Rigveda. Shankara Bhagavatpada has not written commentary on that Upanishad, but still he quotes that Upanishad also often in his commentaries. And this is the information we get for this Aitareya Upanishad. So there's a parampara, Guru Parampara is verse, there's a Guru Parampara verse which also shows Shankara Bhagavatpada in the middle of the parampara. What does it mean? He is shown only in the middle of the parampara means this teaching is timeless teaching which has been there beginninglessly. It has been being preserved by the unbroken lineage of teachers and which has been coming down until this day, which means Vyasa Bhagavan or Shankara Bhagavatpada, they're all only the teachers who revived this wisdom. They are not founders. They're not the Shankara Bhagavatpada has not established this teaching. He re-established, you can say, it is not his new discovery or intention, because many people mistake Shankara's Advaita. It's not Shankara's Advaita. Upanishadic Advaita Darshanam, Vedantic vision is Advaitam, which was only re-established by Shankara Bhagavatpada as an Acharya. You all must have heard this beautiful verse. Narayanam Padma Bhavam Vasishtam Shaktincha Tatputra Parasharancha Vyasam Shukam Gaudapadam Mahantam Govinda Yogindra Mathasya Sishyam Shri Shankaracharya Mathasya Sishyam Padma Padam Cha Hastamalakam Cha Sishyam Tam Totakam Vartika Karamanyan Asmat Gurun Santata Manatosmi. Do you want to write down? Okay. Nice to remember. I want to start the day thinking of all the gurus. Narayanam Padma Bhuvam Vasishtham Shaktincha Tatputra Parasharancha. I'll repeat. Narayanam Padma Bhuvam Vasishtam Shaktincha Tatputra Parasharancha Vyasam Shukam Gaudapadam Mahantam Vyasam Shukam Gaudapadam Mahantam Gaudapadam Mahantam Govinda Yogindra Mathasya Sishyam Govinda Yogindra Mathasya Sishyam Govinda Yogindra Mathasya Sishyam Yamathasya Sishyam Shri Shankaracharyam Athasya Padma Padancha Hastamalakancha Sishyam Shri Shankaracharya Mathasya Sishyam Padma Padancha Hastamalakancha Sishyam Tam Totakam Vartikakaram Anyan Asmat Gurun Santatamanatosmi Santatam Anatosmi. This is the verse. So, Santatam Anataha Asmi. Asmi, I am, I remain bowing, saluting all our teachers who are in this unbroken lineage, which begins with Bhagavan Narayana, Brahma, Narayanam, Padmabhavam, then Vasishta. then Shaktihi, then Parashara. Parashara is Vyasa. Vyasa. Then his son Shuka. Then in between them, many must have gone. Then we come to know Gaudapada. Then Shankaracharya. See where is Shankaracharya's position in the parampara. The known list, unknown list also is there. We just say, begin with Bhagavan, Narayana and Brahma. Afterwards, we have a big lineage. We don't know in between how many gurus would have been there. Then, we just mentioned, that this verse mentioned Shankaracharya somewhere in between. Vyasa and Shankaracharya also come only in between. So we do not know. Then we say after Shankaracharya, we had Totakacharya, all of them. Asmad Guru, so all our teachers who are now. Asmad Guru, so the huge, there's a big lineage of teachers beginning from Bhagavan means the teaching is beginningless. So the teaching will be endless also. How? Whoever is the latest teacher, until the teacher, the teaching is there. It will be continued. That's why it is Anadi Parampara. Karna Parampara, Anadi Parampara. So why I wanted to mention this, it must be very clear for us that Shankara Bhagavan, I had to mention this. Why 10 major Upanishads? In mentioning these are the 10 major Upanishads, I have to mention that Shankara Bhagavatpada has written commentary on them. And Shankara Bhagavatpada has written commentary on them because Vyasacharya has chosen them in his chosen mantras from these 10 Upanishads mainly for his analysis. If we have to have clear understanding of the teaching, we must definitely see how these mantras have been analyzed in the Brahma Sutras. If to understand that, we must have the basic Anajjati Upanishads. So we need a commentary. Which means, it is possible for people to mistake maybe Vyasacharya as in Brahma Sutrani. So he is the founder. No, that is not true. Which means every teacher is said to be known as a mere pipeline, empty pipeline. Only through the pipe, the wisdom, the reservoir of wisdom is the Veda Shastram, from where the wisdom is flowing through the pipes of teachers. Which means the tradition never gives importance for the teacher. In tradition, teachers are revered, but the importance is given for the teaching. Okay, that is the fact I must remind you here. Now, if we take this, Aitareya Upanishad, the very word Aitareya makes it very clear that in Rigveda also, we have all the different parts of the Veda. You remember the end we have seen before also, any Veda Shastra, the entire Veda Shastram consists of four parts. You all know that very well. Brahmanam, the first Samhita, Brahmanam, Aranyakam and Upanishad. The whole Veda, any Veda you take, the entire Veda also can be divided into four parts as Samhita Bhagaha, Brahmana Bhagaha, Aranyaka Bhagaha and Upanishad Bhagaha. It's a Bhagaha as a portion. And the Samhita part of the Veda consists of hymns of praise. So Samhita portion of the Veda consists of many hymns of praise known as Suktani. You must have heard of many Suktams, Purusha Suktam, Sri Suktam, all different, so many Suktas. The hymns of praise wherein we invoke the grace of different Devatas. Okay? This is Samhita. Hymns in praise of, the hymns of praise presenting the glorifications of Devatas. Known as Suktani. Suktam, Suktani. Then the next portion, Brahmana portion, is actually the biggest portion of the Veda. The Brahmana portion alone presents all about the know-how of rituals, the performance of rituals, the relevant mantras for relevant rituals, the devatas to be invoked in a given ritual, the benefits of rituals, the method of performing the rituals, all about rituals are elaborately discussed in the Brahmana portion of the Veda Shastra. And then comes the Aranyakam. Aranyakam, the very word Aranyam means jungle. Aranyakam portion discusses the Upasanani, mainly meditations. So we can say, is Brahmanam and Aranyakam discuss the karma part. Karma means, so Kayika Pradhanam, the predominantly body, the physical body is involved in the rituals prescribed in the Brahmana portion, whereas Upasanam is a Manasa Pradhanam, means predominantly mind involved activities. Which means even worship, etc. When you do worship also, their body and mind are involved. When you suppose now we did the ritual now. In this ritual, we were chanting, oral activity, we did namaskaram, physical activity. We also quietly pray. Mind was also here. Mind was not going elsewhere. So in this, it is also called Upasanam. Upasanam mainly a mental activity. In worship and prayer, body is involved, speech is involved, and of course, mind must be definitely totally involved. Therefore, in these two portions, we can say the rituals and the Brahmana portion specifically presents the rituals, and Aranyaka portion specifically presents the meditations. Is it clear? Okay. Now, the last portion is Upanishad. Now, like that, in Rig Veda, like how we saw previously, Yajurveda Brahmanam, Yajurveda Aranyakam, in Krishna Yajurveda, in Aranyaka portion, we found Taittiriya Upanishad. We saw Taittiriya Upanishad forms the last portion, 7th, 8th, 9th chapters of Taittiriya Aranyakam. Exactly here also, this Aitareya Brahmanam, and there is Aitareya Aranyakam. With Aitareya Aranyakam alone, we see this Aitareya Aranyakam. After that comes Aitareya Upanishad. Aitreya Upanishad comes in after the Aitreya Aranyaka portion. So we must know. It means the rituals of the Rig Veda, meditations discussed in the Rig Veda, they all are over. After presenting the rituals, or the suktams, or even the meditations, now purely the Upanishadic teaching comes. Rig Veda Upanishadic teaching comes. That is where this Aitreya Upanishad is found in the after the Aitreya Aranyaka section. Have you made it clear? Okay. Now, the name of the Upanishad. How does this word Aitreya, how does this Upanishad get the name Aitreya? Not only the Upanishad, the entire Brahmanam, the Rig Veda portion. In the Rig Veda, there is a big portion of Aitreya Brahmanam, Aitreya Aranyakam, Aitreya Samhita, Aitreya Brahmanam, Aranyakam, then Aitreya Upanishad comes. Means not only Upanishad portion, also Aranyakam and Brahmana portions, which are attributed to the Rishi Aitreya. The Upanishad is known after the name of the Rishi Aitareyaha. Aitareyaha is the name of the Rishi. And we have some story also after that. Even though Upanishad does not insist that our attention must be paid to the background of the Rishi, Upanishad never says we must pay attention to the Rishis. In the sense, knowing about the Rishis, what was this Rishi, who was his father, who was his mother, where does he come from, where was he born, etc. Rishi Moolam should not be asked, it seems. Rishi Moolam, Nadi Moolam, never ask. Never ever go work for tracing the root, okay, origin of the river under Rishi. That's what they say. Because the teaching is more important than the knowing about the origin of the person, etc. One reason. Another reason is the beginninglessness of the knowledge also is meant by this expression, never ever ask for the Rishi Moolam. Origin of the Rishi. Anyway, still we have some small information here. The author of this book, the person who has presented this book, Panology, also has mentioned it in his introduction. It seems the Rishi Aitareya's original name was Mahidasaha. Mahidasaha. Mahidasaha means servant of the earth. Mahi means earth. Maybe it can be taken as the servant of Devi. Mahidasaha. We have Krishna Dasaha, we all know. Like that, we have Mahidasaha. Many names are. Dasaha means servant. People like to be known as the servant of the Lord. I am the servant of the Lord. Mahidasaha is the name of this. Original name of this author of the Upanishad. And his mother's name was Itara, it seems. Itara was his mother's name. Therefore, Itarayaha Apatyam Puman Aitareyaha. The son of Itara is known as Aitareyaha. One meaning is given. And Itara means other. Itara means other. And there is also assumption that the Rishi, Aitreya's father, the Rishi, must have had a second wife. And he must have been, because the word Itara means other. Other means it implies a second wife. Maybe he was a son of a second wife of a rishi. Therefore, he is known as Aitareyaha. This is another meaning given. Anyway, what I wanted to tell you here, this Aitareyaha was once somewhere insulted, it seems. He felt he was insulted in somewhere, some occasion. In a given occasion, he was insulted and he was very sad and he went to his mother. It seemed that mother prayed to Bhagavan and to relieve him of that pain of being insulted or humiliated. So he had the Bhagavan's grace and he also prayed. And he won Bhagavan's grace, that Bhagavan blessed him with the great vision, wisdom. Bhagavan blessed him with the Rishitvam. Rishitvam means the status of being the Rishi. An ordinary human being can have Rishitvam, the status of being the Rishi. So this Mahidasaha became Aitareya Maharshihi, became a great Rishi. The very word Rishihi means the seer of the truth. Rishati Janati Iti Rishihi. I told you this before also. Which means the very word Rishihi tells, reveals a fact that Upanishadic wisdom is not definitely a speculation of the Rishi's intellect, but it is the revelation through the Rishi. Big difference in understanding. We should not mistake any Upanishadic teaching as the speculation of the Rishis. In fact, Upanishadic teaching is revelation expressed through the Rishis. And to be able to have the that status, condition, to have the facts revealed to them, they must have worked to tune their minds in such a way that they were able to receive the facts, Nimah Mantras. That's why no Rishi really claims the authorship. I am the author of this mantra. I am the writer of this mantra. No Rishi has ever mentioned their names anywhere. You can see that. Because they do not take the authorship. They do not say, I am the author. I am the writer. The book is written by, we always have the author's name. But they do not take this authorship. And many Rishis' names are not even known. Because they know it is not my writing, it's not my speculation, it is only a fact revealed to me by Bhagavan. This is the big import, a big difference in saying it's authored by Rishis or it is Rishi's speculation or it is his revelation. It's the revelation through expressed through the Rishis. This is the about the Aitareya Upanishad topic. Now we have to enter into the Shanti Pataha. Yes, Swamiji.
Swamiji, do we know what was the Varna, the caste of Aitareya Rishi?
Yeah. Actually, Swamiji, the word dasaha, they say, must be a Shudra Jati. Usually they say, see, Sharma is a Brahmana surname. Varma is a Kshatriya surname. Gupta is a Vaishya surname. Dasaha is a Shudra surname. So he may, there's also another contention that he belonged to the low caste family. It does not mean that, not in terms of the jati, anything, not by birth, etc. Because of his duties, the family maybe was involved in such activities, in actions. Because the varna division was based on the duties and karma. So that the word dasaha, they say, it says, it said that he must have been belonging to a Sudra Varna. But still, he became a Brahmana. See, by birth he was a Shudraha. But by Jnanam, by Karma, he became a Brahmana. What Shastram tells every individual human being, even whether a person is born in a Brahmana family or a Kshatriya family or a Shudra family or a Vaishya family, every human being is by birth a Shudraha. Shudraha. And everyone is supposed to become a Brahmana. Ultimately, every human being, irrespective of one's birth, based on one's birth or the choice of actions, the one's inclinations, irrespective of whatever it is, ultimately every human being has to become a Brahmanaha. Brahmanaha means a wise person. A wise person is a Brahmana. An ignorant person is a Shudra. So every human being is born a Shudraha, means every person is born an ignorant. And being born ignorant, it is very natural for one to begin one's life without knowing what is right, what is wrong. So Shastram says, there's a beautiful verse, I mentioned it to you once ago, before I think. Janmana jayate shudraha, karmana dvija uchyate, veda pathena viprasyat, brahmano brahma vedanat. What does it mean? By birth, everyone is a Shudra. Every human being is a Shudra by birth. Because when you are born, when we are growing up as young children, we do not know what is appropriate, what is inappropriate, what is right, what is wrong, what we should do, what we should not do. We do not know. No child knows whether I should go and catch this running lizard or not. I should touch fire or not. So any child who does not know how one should, what one should do, one should not do, the child is said to be a Shudraha. So as children, all of us are Shudras. All human beings are Shudras when they are children. There's a time when the child is able to understand the instructions of parents or elders or teachers. Understanding the instruction takes, don't do, sit here, don't move, don't touch fire, okay, it will burn your finger. Don't touch that insect, it will bite you. When the teachers or elders, when they instruct the children, when the children are able to understand the instructions, that is when they are said to be dvijas. And that much maturity a child has. Only when a child has that much maturity of being able to understand the instructions and follow the instructions, then the child is looked upon as a mature child. Until then, immature, raw-headed child. Every child is raw. Raw-headed means what? Immature. It is nothing wrong in being immature. Shastram sanctions such an immaturity on the part of a child. But Shastram does not accept immaturity on the part of a grown-up person. We can't afford to be immature, innocent throughout life. In the beginning is okay. To begin one's life, it's okay. So then that maturity, which is found on the part of a child, is looked upon as the second birth of a child. That is when a child is called Dvijaha, a grown-up child, not a baby, not a child who cannot understand any instructions, who must be looked after, is called Shudraha, and who does not know what is right and what is wrong. Who needs to be completely looked after is called Shudraha. Whereas a grown-up child who's boy or girl, and as a boy or girl who is able to understand the instructions, and when the instructions are given with love, affection, care, with polite, nice, sweet words, the child follows, is capable of following the instructions, then that child is said to be mature child. That maturity in terms of being able to understand the instructions is said to be the second birth of a child. He is called Dvijaha. Dvijaha means twice born. In fact, any bird is also called twice born. It comes out of the mother's womb in the form of an egg. Then after breaking open the shell, it comes out of the egg. Andajaha is called Dvijaha. Twice born. Any bird is twice born. Lot of, we can see that lizard, etc. They're all twice born. Because lays eggs coming out of the mother's womb first from egg, in the form of egg. Then breaking open the egg, it comes out. Twice born. But here, a mature child is called, child's maturity is looked upon as a second birth. How mature the child is? Not very mature, highly mature. The maturity in terms of being able to understand the instructions and to follow the instructions is called Dvijaha. Because he is able to follow the instructions, he does the right, he avoids the wrong. That's important. So Dvijaha, the twice born, is a mature child who is able to follow the instructions, who is able to do the right, who is able to refrain from what is wrong, is called Dvijaha. But even then, this Dvijaha, who is able to follow the instructions, who is able to do the right, who refrains from the wrong things, does not know why he should do the right, why he should not do the wrong. Which means Dvijaha is the one who follows Dharma, not knowing the value of Dharma. He follows Dharma. He does the right, he avoids the wrong. But he does not know the value of Dharma. Does not know why I should do the right, why I should not do the wrong. That he does not know. That is why he is better than a Shudra. He is mature when compared to a Shudraha, who does not know right and wrong. Whereas there's a Vipraha. Vipraha is a person who is exposed to the teaching. A grown-up person who is exposed to the teaching, thereby who is capable of understanding the value of Dharma, who also knows the consequence of not following the Dharma, who knows the consequence, the effect of, the efficacy of following Dharma. That if I do not follow Dharma, I'll incur sin, and the sin will be translated into the experience of pain. If I follow dharma, it will result in the accumulation of punyam, which will contribute for my peaceful life. Bless me with the pleasures. So experience of pain and pleasure is dependent on my following dharma and adharma. Therefore, vipraha is said to be a more mature individual who follows dharma, knowing the value of dharma. I got this topic because of Swamiji's question. Follows dharma. And such a person, not only he knows the value of dharma simply, that following dharma will bless him with the pleasure, not following dharma will punish him with the pain, will result in the punishment of going through pain. No, not only that, he knows ultimate goal is moksha, and for that moksha, jnanam is the only means. And if the knowledge of the truth has to rise in the mind, mind must be prepared, and mental preparedness, the mental purification and mental steadiness is possible. Mental purity, mental steadiness required for the attainment of jnanam is possible only if I strictly follow the dharma, if I live a life of dharma. Such a person having moksha as the purushartha, having the knowledge as the only means, being committed to the pursuit of knowledge, in order to prepare his mind for knowledge, knowing the value of dharma, who strictly lives a life of dharma, is said to be a more mature individual. He is called vipraha. And finally, Shastram says, the most mature individual is the jnani, the wise person, who has discovered Brahman, who has attained the knowledge of Brahman. So by following dharma strictly, having prepared his mind for jnanam, and with the help of the Shastram and the Guru, the person who has discovered the truth as the self, and one who is reveling in the vision of the truth, a jnani, is said to be a brahmana, the most mature individual. So one cannot become more mature than a jnani. And Vedanta Shastram, or the Veda Shastram, wants every individual to become a brahmana, the most mature individual, a jnani. Because the freedom, the happiness, the absolute tranquility is in wisdom. So it is the knowledge of the truth, knowledge of the self, which is said to be wisdom. So everyone is by birth a shudraha. Everyone becomes dvijaha. It is not enough if we become dvijaha. We should also become a vipraha. And from being the stage of being a vipra, we should also become brahmanaha. Everyone should become a brahmanaha also. Therefore, brahmanaha is the most mature, a person of accomplishment, achievement, whose life is really a meaningful, complete and successful life. Therefore, Aitreya Rishi also is a brahmanaha. By his wisdom and vision, he earned Bhagavan's grace. got, he had the rishi status, and he has contributed for the whole Aitareya Brahmanam, Aitareya Aranyakam, Aitareya Upanishad. Therefore, Shankara Bhagavatpada acknowledges his contribution, is it in his commentary on this. He himself says in this Manisha Panchakam, even my teacher is, whether he is a chandala, whether he is a dog eater, or whether he is an ordinary person, slum dweller, doesn't matter. If he has wisdom, he is my guru. He must be revered as guru. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.